Hello, and a very warm welcome to LNT Royal YouTube channel.
Meghan closed for the night and virtual summit, interviewing its co-founder and CEO Emily Ramshaw. We're just happy that this whole thing was live. After a week of 19 news reporters interviewing the nation's top women in politics, Meghan turned the tables on the 19th, interviewing Emily about their mission to create a transformative newsroom centered on gender equity. The session follows 4 days of live, streamed talks between women in politics, civics, journalism, and the arts.
Well, I am so excited to be here with you today, Emily. Obviously, what you have created with the 19th is something so special and so important. And when I, you know, as we had our conversation just a couple weeks ago, I thought, how can I best support this initiative and this incredible media platform? And as much of as you have these great conversations throughout the week, obviously in the interviews that you've done, as opposed to doing that, I thought, how better to serve this and to have a conversation asking you how this came to be and really the impact and goals that you have for the 19th, which I am blown away by, but just wanted to take the time to be able to have that conversation with you.
Wonderful. Well, obviously this is an enormous honor for us to get to be part of this conversation. I would be lying if I said this wasn't a completely surreal, amazing experience for us to get to have. And we are just really, really appreciative that these are issues that you deeply care about and thrilled to get to be in this conversation with you. So I am an open book. I'm not used to being the one in the hot seat, but go for it.
Based on what we have a shared interest in, and of course, just the goals of the 19th, but also just our commonality as women, right? What we go through as women who are balancing work, raising children, all of those things, I think for me made it really compelling to just have this conversation on a really human level, as well as one on the professional level. So we can just jump right in if that works for you.
I'm ready.
How did this come to be? Where did the idea come from? How long did it take it to come to fruition? And was this timing planned for you? Obviously not having any sense of COVID-19 or Black Lives Matter and all of this being where we sit right now, but knowing that this ramp up to the celebrating the 19th Amendment, was this all part of your plan?
You know, it honestly wasn't. This all began for me 4 years ago. You know, Hillary Clinton was running for president. I had a brand new newborn baby girl. I was on maternity leave, and you know, in between sort of the dark moments of postpartum depression and changing diapers and being covered in spit up, I was listening to these conversations on, you know, 24-hour cable news around women and electability, women and likability. And it might have been the hormones talking in that moment, but I just felt enormous rage. These were still conversations that we were having in 2016. And I thought in that moment, you know what we really need is a new national newsroom by and for women that throws sort of those questions of electability and likability out the window, and that really covers women deeply with empathy and with respect. And then I went back to, you know, raising a newborn. Honestly, it just sort of fluttered right out of my brain. And then almost 4 years later, we were looking at a campaign cycle with more women than we've ever seen before on the 2020 campaign trail. All of these same questions were getting asked over and over again, and it just felt like a moment. I could see the light. I had a toddler instead of an infant. I thought, this is a moment, and if I don't take this moment, you know, what a missed opportunity. So that was about a year ago. You know, here we are. We have just launched the 19th, the country's first nonprofit, nonpartisan newsroom at the intersection of gender, politics, and policy. And yes, as you mentioned, the world has changed in an enormous way in the last 6 months alone. And I'm happy to get into some of that conversation. But what a moment to be starting this work. We are over the moon that it's just begun.
Well, I mean, it's really incredible if you think about the timing, and I'm sure in some ways, I would imagine you may have taken a moment and said, should we shift this date? Should we launch at a different time? Especially having so many women who work for your organization, which in and of itself, I think is very important and powerful right now, but also comes with its own challenges with what moms are juggling at the moment, with homeschooling their kids, with, you know, obviously working from home. And I'm curious how that's affected the staffing that you have with the 19th, and if that's something that you've all rallied around in sort of a sisterhood to support each other through, which is what I imagine the case is, but also what sort of nuances come up in that that you may have not anticipated, obviously not knowing what this landscape would be like right now.
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, we did take a break, as you mentioned. We, in the month of February, my husband was diagnosed with COVID. I was like underwater trying to fundraise for this venture with a four-year-old daughter at home, who I was literally stiff-arming to keep out of my fundraising calls, you know, while my husband was basically groaning in the background. I mean, it was like just this surreal experience. And my colleagues and I, we stopped and we thought, you know, maybe we can't do this in this moment. Our fundraising took an enormous hit. The corporate revenue market really sort of dried up. We thought, my God, you know, all of this work, we're going to have to hire all of these people virtually if we're able to do it at all. Should we just pause? Should we just wait a year to ride this out? But then the realities were the stories were so important. Women were being disproportionately affected by this pandemic in basically every arena except for mortality rates. Whether it was, you know, the job losses in this economic recession, whether it was the frontline healthcare workers being, you know, infected with COVID, the childcare burden, obviously, that we've talked about a lot. We really realized in this moment, our calling was more important than it had ever been. And so it was an enormous risk. It's still an enormous risk, candidly, but we felt like we had to jump in, you know, with 2 feet. Now, having a team that is, first of all, our team is not all women. We're 91% women. Lots of folks with small children, with elderly parents, you know, navigating that sandwich generation. We never imagined all of these really generous leave policies that we had put into place, all of these flexible remote work conditions, that we would need to take advantage of them all at once, which is what happens when a global pandemic hits. But it has been extraordinarily beautiful and moving to have this team of people who treat each other and the women they cover with empathy. You know, almost every Zoom call we're on, there's somebody feeding a baby a bottle or trying to, you know, get their kid to play on the iPad without disrupting the entire call. It's just, this is a moment. And it's so special to be doing this in an environment with this many extraordinary women and journalists.
Well, and also that in many ways you're capturing this moment in such an extraordinary way, because it's almost like it all came to a head at the same time for you. Obviously, you know, in this launch, and I can't wait to see so many of these interviews that people have been able to watch over the last week, but I think what's so compelling is that even looking at all the risk there, you did it. You just took that jump and you took that leap of faith. And I think there's so much that we can all learn from that, that in those moments where it might feel scary, you just seem to trust your gut and go, this is the right time to do this. And so I think there's a lot to celebrate for you doing that. You know, I am also really aware that obviously in the media landscape at the moment, having women's voices be able to be part of that storytelling is so key. I think as we're looking at, as you say, speaking to compassion and empathy and all of those as an undercurrent of how this reporting is happening, how do you think the reporting from the journalists you have is going to be shaped just by virtue of being women, being mothers, you know, and that role, and how it'll be covered, how things like COVID, for example, will be covered differently from the 19th than it would be on some other platform?
Right. Those are great questions. I mean, I think, you know, starting with the sort of pandemic within a pandemic of racial injustice in this country, one of the first big stories we broke, we were the first national outlet really to elevate the Breonna Taylor case. And that was because Breonna Taylor's family came to one of our extraordinary reporters, our editor at large, Aaron Haynes, and said, you know, we feel like Black men who are being killed by police are having their stories elevated in a way that Black women who are killed by police are not. And for us, that was an extraordinary gender lens on a story that really propelled the nation into conversations around Say Her Name. You know, when you think about COVID and this moment and this pandemic, you know, childcare is so front and center to getting this economy back on track, to ensuring that women, this isn't a lost generation of women in the workforce. And so many of our stories are framed through that lens. You know, the reality is, In this industry, the overwhelming majority of politics and policy reporters and editors are men, and almost all of them are white men. And what that means is that those are the people deciding what's news and what isn't, whose voices are elevated, which experts are quoted, whether those stories play on the front page or the home page. So it feels for us critical in this moment more than ever. You know, I'd love to ask you, obviously, like, you are someone who has been deeply covered by the media in so many ways, many
Hold
of them.
Hold on a second, I thought, here we go. I'm gonna stop you at a certain point because I get to wear the journalist hat today. But yes, oh, please, of course, no, go for it.
All right. I mean, what I want to ask you is, why do you think that we need a woman-focused news organization? How do you think coverage is different, will be different, with women and people of color at the helm?
Well, do you know what's so interesting is, and I was actually reading just a couple weeks ago, this fascinating article about the suffrage movement. And what resonated with me about it is specifically the term suffragette. And you'll follow my train of thinking in a moment, because the impetus for the word suffragette started in a UK newspaper in 1906, and it was meant to belittle the women who were part of the suffrage movement. It's like, oh, we'll just add a little et to the end here.
Minimizing, yes.
And what I find so fascinating is that was then, before digital media, before the online space, before things could travel around the world with rapid fire, and the American women as part of the suffrage movement didn't want to be called suffragettes, and yet this term, coined by one man, in 1906, has stuck as part of a movement. And I think when you look at that and you look at it through that lens of the power of one person's influence in the media to be able to shape an entire movement or way of thinking or even an ideology or an identification, if women have their voice heard as equally, how different that would have been. Right. And so even though in that article, the point was not about the term suffragette, what stuck with me is the ability of influence. And if it's only coming from a patriarchal lens, how that's shaping everything that we see. And whether you actually read the article or not, this one or any other one, I think what's so fascinating, at least from my standpoint and my personal experience the past couple of years, is the headline alone, the clickbait alone makes an imprint. That is part of how we start to view the world, how we interact with other people. And I think there's so much toxicity out there in what is being referred to. My husband and I talk about it often, this economy for attention, right? That is what is monetizable right now when you're looking at the digital space and media. And so if you're just trying to grab someone's attention and keep it, you're going for something salacious versus something truthful. And I think that once we can get back to the place, which is what you're creating here, which is why I think it's so important, where people are just telling the truth in their reporting and telling it through a compassionate or empathetic lens, it's going to help bind people as community in a way that I think the moment we're feeling much more of a disconnect in a space where we could be feeling more of a connection.
Absolutely. I mean, and I think the business model plays into this, honestly. I mean, part of the reason, honestly, the majority of the reason we launched the 19th as a nonprofit newsroom, as a member-supported newsroom, is so that we have that flexibility, so that we aren't, you know, chasing advertiser-based clicks, so that we aren't, you know, chasing the most salacious headline. We have the time and the space to tell stories the way that they ought to be told, to tell them with empathy, that, you know, in ways that honor women's lives and experiences, that give them depth, you know. Our reporters are based all over the country. They're not all in DC and New York and LA. They are in Des Moines, Iowa. They're in Orlando, Florida. They're in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. They're telling real women's stories, telling those stories where they are. There's no such thing for us as sort of flyover country, right? I mean, this is, this country is filled with women who are not monolithic. This is a nuanced voting block and we ought to treat them like that.
Well, and I think what's so fascinating too, to that point, obviously with, you know, this year's election and the voting is so incredibly important and something I'm very passionate about. I was talking yesterday with Gloria Steinem, who I've connected with recently, and legend, right? So you just go, how fantastic to be able to have that time. But talking about the importance of the vote, and even right now, the census isn't going to be able to be completed this year because of COVID. And you think about women who are in marginalized communities or areas where they aren't going to be able to be accounted for, how special, as you say, that with the 19th, you don't simply have reporters in these large cities, but you have a representation all throughout the country and in pockets where you might not normally hear those voices, but they are so valuable to be heard because it helps us understand what each of us are going through as opposed to this broad stroke. I think it's key. I think, you know, that alone is really going to shape the kind of storytelling that you're going to be able to do there. So how do you think the 19th's work will change how people consume news? I think right now, as we sort of touched on, so many people are just getting these pop-ups and alerts, but do you think people are going to go looking for this type of news because it will nourish them in a different way potentially, or it'll inspire them in a different way?
I mean, I hope so. What you are seeing in, honestly, the last few days since we launched is an enormous outpouring of support. Thousands and thousands of people becoming members, supporting us with their hard-earned dollars. You know, thousands of additional people subscribing for our newsletters every given day. I mean, I think there really is a hunger for this kind of coverage. But for us, it isn't enough to draw readers into our fold on our platforms. Honestly, we have a moral obligation to meet women where they already are. And for me, that means making our journalism entirely free to republish by every other news organization in America. So we have launched with a terrific partnership with Univision. Univision is translating our work into Spanish and distributing it. The USA Today Network is distributing our work to more than 260 regional newspaper markets, which is just unbelievable for us to be able to reach that kind of audience from day one. And, you know, then across social media, you know, across, yes, there's a lot of toxicity there. If you can find your way to the right platforms like ours, you know, our obligation really is to find women on the platforms they're already using, they're already consuming, and make sure we're getting those really critical headlines in front of them.
I mean, I think what's going to be really interesting to see now, having this kind of media platform for not just women who are our peers, for example, but for young women who are, I'm always so inspired by these women who are in high school, for example, who are just mobilizing to this next chapter of their life, and they're so engaged and so ready to be the leaders of the next generation. And this kind of content, their ability to be able to not have to seek it out or find it, and it will probably really shape so much in how people are able to mobilize, just having those assets at the tip of their fingers.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what we're hoping, honestly, across the generational spectrum. I mean, I think in many ways, it's just as important for us to be telling stories of older women who are, you know, in many ways feeling like they're left out of a national dialogue on these issues. It's been fascinating to have a staff that really sort of crosses both the generational and the, you know, socioeconomic, you know, racial divide. It's been really extraordinary to build a truly empathetic and representative team, which is something you don't have the luxury of getting to do if you're sort of trying to turn the Titanic of a major legacy news organization. The freedom and flexibility we've had to say, you know what, we're going to build the most representative newsroom in America. We're going to do it from day one. We're going to hire these extraordinary people from all walks of life, from all backgrounds, and give them the opportunity to elevate their voices and advance them in leadership in this organization. We hope we're setting the gold standard for the rest of the industry.
I mean, I can't imagine that you wouldn't be, right? And people are craving a change. I think in the place that we're all in right now, there's such a moment where people are starting to question the systems that we've always believed in, where we're getting our information from as well. And I think, you know, you want to have trust in journalism, and you want to have trust in what you're reading, and the hope that it's fact. I mean, I think we've become so sadly comfortable with the idea that we are just getting all this stuff and it becomes noise as opposed to truth and accurate journalism. So I think, you know, if this can be the catalyst for reset for other news organizations, my goodness, it's going to change the game so much, and specifically that it's bipartisan. You know, I think when I have these conversations about encouraging people to go out and vote, I think it's often challenging for men and women alike, but certainly for people to remember just how hard it was to get the right to vote and to be really aware of not taking that for granted. I mean, I look at that, my husband, for example, he's never been able to vote. And I think it's such an interesting thing to say the right to vote is not a privilege, it is a right in and of itself. But I really do hope that what you're able to encourage and what we're able to see happen through the 19th over the course of the next few months is that women understand that their voices are needed now more than ever, and the best way to exercise that is through voting.
Absolutely. I mean, we are in a pivotal moment in history. You know, the centennial of the 19th Amendment, which is upon us, extended the right to vote to white women. The asterisk in our logo is a signal of how far we have left to go. It took another four decades for women of color to be extended the same rights. In many states in this country, honestly, voter suppression is still a thing, and women are struggling yet to have their voices heard. So I think this moment, this anniversary, is so critical. We hope to be one piece of the pie of giving women the representation and the elevation of voice that they deserve.
And I didn't realize that that's why you have the asterisks. That makes complete sense. I love that, because it is, it's that just sort of addendum to what we're celebrating, but with the same awareness that it's not fully a celebration. There is still so much work to do. And you think about the Voting Rights Act and how even at this point, I was having this conversation just yesterday, it feels like we make so many strides forward, and yet there's still so much more to do. And so I think what will be fascinating is to watch now with this sort of ability for people to consume news in a very real way, that they will be able to accelerate that pace at which we get the change that we all deserve.
Well, I think we're also in a moment of racial reckoning in this country, and it's been really, honestly, stunning to watch all of this evolve as we were getting the 19th off the ground. Look, I am a white woman of privilege. I am the child of two journalists. I have had every opportunity. You know, the fact that I'm able to get this venture off the ground in this moment is almost predictable. What feels most empowering about this moment is that I have the opportunity to elevate the voices of women and other underserved people who have been underrepresented for so long. And I feel this obligation to make the business model work, to make the fundraising work, to build this platform so that women can have their voices heard. I'm curious what it has been like for you coming back to the United States, you know, in this moment as a biracial woman in this moment of all these conversations around race and justice. What has that felt like for you? If I can turn the tables for a minute.
Of course. You know, I touched on this a couple months ago, actually, right when I had come back, and I said a few words for my high school alma mater for their graduating class, because I had come back after being away for so long, and because really I haven't lived in the States for almost 10 years. I lived in Canada for 7 years for work, so it's a really long lapse in time from being here. And to come back and to just see the state of affairs, I think at the onset, if I'm being honest, it was just devastating. It was so sad to see where our country was in that moment. And if there's any silver lining in that, I would say that in the weeks that were happening after the murder of George Floyd, in the peaceful protests you were seeing, in the voices that were coming out, in the way that people were actually owning their role and acknowledging their role that they played either actively or passively in the discrimination of other people, specifically of the Black community, it shifted from sadness to a feeling of absolute inspiration, because I can see that the tide is turning. And I think for so many of us, it's very easy to focus on the negativity. It's very easy to focus on that because it's what you hear out there, right? As I think I said to the high school girls when I was speaking to them, the loudest voices are often the negative ones, sadly. So I think, you know, from my standpoint, it's not new to see this undercurrent of racism and certainly unconscious bias. But I think to see the changes that are being made right now is something that I look forward to being a part of, and being a part of using my voice in a way that I haven't been able to up late. So yeah, it's good to be home.
We're all ready for it too.
It's good to be home. You know, I think, look, as we're sort of wrapping things up, and I know there's so much that you're going to continue to do with this platform, what is the role that we as supporters can play in this to keep the 19th true to its mission, to be able to play our part in this storytelling? You know, for all of the people who are watching this going, I want to be engaged in some way, how do we best support you?
Absolutely. Thank you for asking that terrific question. So the best way to support us, honestly, is to read. It's to consume everything that we're producing. It's to subscribe for our newsletters, which are all free. It's to attend our live events like this one, which are all free. And probably most important is, if you love what you're reading and you believe in our mission, to support us with your hard-earned dollars if you can. You can do that at 19thnews.org. We would love to have you in our founding circle as low as $19 a month. So, but honestly, the most important piece for us is your engagement. Tell us your stories, share your stories with us, be part of our community. We are so excited to have this opportunity, and we can't wait to, you know, beautifully reflect the women and other underserved people in this country.
It's amazing. I mean, and if I wasn't already just so excited about everything that you're doing, I would be sad to not mention that we both also went to Northwestern. So I feel especially proud, again, supporting an alma mater, but just to see how you've been able to bring this to life. And especially, you know, I think as a woman, also as a mother of a young child, just that you're able to balance it all and to use the sliver of extra time that you have, because I know what it's like with a toddler. There's not a lot of time, but to use that for the good of others, to use that in this creation of something that's going to benefit so many people. And, you know, I think your acknowledgement of where you come from and what your upbringing was like didn't have to tee you up for this, right? And so whether that's a testament to your parents or how you were raised or certainly to you, I just think it really needs to be applauded that you've made this active choice to serve women in underserved communities and to allow all of our voices to be heard. I think it's just excellent, and I can't wait to see everything that you guys accomplish.
Well, I would be remiss if I didn't call out the extraordinary people on our team, the journalists and others who are making all of this possible, because they are phenomenal human beings beyond being phenomenal journalists. We are so thrilled that you chose to take part in the 19th Represents. This was just really game-changing for us and an extraordinary experience for me. And my daughter will be over the moon to be watching these videos from here till kingdom come. So.
Oh my gosh, how sweet. What's her name?
Her name is Sophie.
Hi, Sophie.
Please support growing LMT Royal Channel by subscribe channel, like and share videos are. Your support is the motivation for our to produce better videos. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more LMT Royal videos about your favorite royals are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.